questions, I will post a third today. I keep saying that to someone. Today, today. It really will be today.
I heard that on
Okay.
calculations of amplitude and frequency, increasing stimulus voltage, duration, and frequency. Again, and this is where the grass stimulator is going to come in, where the biopack system is going to come in. Okay, so I have this graph here. Last you have in a minute, right? Beats per minute. So if you know one, therefore we're activating more alpha motor neurons and therefore more muscles, right, to cause contraction. Spatial sensation. All right, and then in lab, our alpha motor neurons recruited first because they have a lower resistance to direct stimulation, which was the opposite of our Henneman size principle, right? So we recruited our larger motor units first. And then in part three, we injected tuberculari. And then tuberculari did what to our tension? We had a decrease or a completely disappeared our tension. And that is because tuberculari is a competitive inhibitor of the acetylcholine receptor. So it binds with acetylcholine for the binding site. And then we need the acetylcholine receptor for depolarization. We have no depolarization, no calcium, no contraction.
That's the next portion. You said rotor force decreased because you have less muscle fibers.
Structural
lives,
less muscle fibers. We did a direct simulation before tuberculari. Would that mess up either of the experiments?
No.
No, right? Okay. So I think I've read some or some lab reports said, like, that's why we did tuberculari first.
Do you think if we had done direct simulation first, it would have had a greater increase in tension for direct simulation?
Versus
doing, so if we'd done the experiment with direct simulation before the experiment with tuberculari, do you think we would have had a greater increase in tension with the direct simulation experiment?
No.
So it's not like they would summate the, oh, I guess because we wouldn't even be touching the sciatic nerve, so.
Yeah, we're completely bypassing the whole sciatic nerve, and then tuberculari, yeah, it had nothing to do with each other. I think in some of my reports I was reading that you guys were saying tuberculari was messed, like whole messed up the sciatic nerve or something, and then therefore we, that's why we do drug stimulation, but you, they don't matter for each other. Alright, lab 3, human reflexes. So you guys should know all components of the reflex arc. With the H reflex, Hopkin reflex, we have the H wave, the N wave, motor neurons, you know, Renshaw cells, antidromic and orthodromic action potentials, refractory period, vestibular ocular reflex, hair cells, nystagmus, and then overall, we tested monosynaptic, which is polysynaptic reflexes, our muscle spindles. Alright, so part one, in our monosynaptic reflex, for Hopkin reflex, we stimulated the what nerve? Tibial nerve. And recorded the electroactivity of the
because it has like a shorter distance to travel.
Yes and yes. But what about size wise?
It's a larger diameter. The one day afferent is a larger diameter than the alpha neuron. So when you artificially stimulate it, it has a lower
threshold. Yeah. Yeah, so same thing as the last one, right? So your 1A afferents are larger in diameter, so they have a lower threshold, easier to excite. So that's why we should have seen our H wave first. So some of you guys saw your M wave first, but it's okay, it's fine. Have our antidromic collision. M wave. And your M wave is going both orthodromic and antidromic directions, which causes the refractory period, and therefore you have the antidromic collision, which is why your H wave should decrease. Okay, and then we increase frequency, and that will happen to our H wave after that. And then, so frequency, this was due to your Renshaw cell. So at higher frequency, your alpha motor neurons cannot recover from the recurrent inhibition by the Renshaw cells, making your alpha motor neurons less responsive to your 1A afferent stimulations. Okay? Like I said, remember voltage, antidromic collision, frequency is due to your Renshaw cells. And then we move on to our polysynaptic reflexes, which is when we start spinning our subjects in the chair. So the first case, when we spun the subject slowly with their eyes closed, and remember they were showing us with their thumbs which way they perceived they were being spun. So in the beginning of the spin, remember we went through this table, your hair cells bending clockwise. In the middle of your spin, your endolymph catches up with your hair cells, so there's no bend in them. So your subject should have perceived no motion in the middle of the spin. And then at the end of the spin, your hair cells bend counterclockwise, and your subject should perceive the opposite direction. That's because your endolymph moves slower than the body. Looking at which way the fast movement was and the slow movement was. So which way was the rapid eye movement going? Yeah, with the spin, and then your slow eye movement was going opposite of the spin. And then the case three and four was your subject was spinning in the chair really fast, and then I stopped them and then opened their eyes, and then you should have seen the nystagmus again. And which way should the rapid eye movement go? Yeah, opposite the spin, and the slow eye movement should have been with the spin. And then what was the difference between case three and four? Yeah, so your subject at that point then leaned their head to their shoulder really far, and then that way we activated another canal, and you should see the same thing, but at an angle now. Taking blood pressure from each other. What is the first sound that you hear?
Systolic.
Systolic pressure?
Okay.
which one's turbulent and which one's laminar flow?
Systolic is turbulent.
Is which one?
Systolic is turbulent.
Yeah, systolic is your turbulent flow, and then diastolic is your laminar flow. That was one of his questions. Obviously not just straightforward like that. So L-A-M-I-N-A-R. And then for part two, that's when we brought up the tilt table, and your subject was laying, standing on a tilt table, first lay down for a few minutes, for 5 minutes, and then we abruptly tilted them straight forward. So from supine to the upright position will initially cause what to your blood pressure?
Decrease.
But then over time your blood pressure will come back to normal. Anybody? Why is both your parasympathetic and sympathetic activity activated? What? Yeah. held their head, they just held their breath over the water without actually putting in there, and then that should have caused an increase, just based on anticipation. And then once they actually put their face in the water, that was when you saw a decrease, hopefully. The what?
I guess I'm just confused why heart rate would slow down. I mean, I would think that would only be due to parasympathetic activation, not sympathetic activation.
Yes. So why would your sympathetic?
Oh, I was just wondering, maybe it's because you don't really need to use your test, like your GI tract while you're underwater. So maybe, because you're not going to be in there for a while, maybe your autonomic system just kind of like, just trying to get you out of the water. So then maybe blood flow, it has to do with blood flow to certain areas, and other areas, it's not necessary.
So do you think it'd be different if it was not just the face submerged in cold water? Like if it was the whole body submerged in cold water, do you think it'd be different if it wasn't just the face?
Mm-hmm.
Or yeah, or any other, yeah, I guess, or any other body. Well, that wouldn't limit blood flow though. So we won't have to know in that much detail then. I mean, I was just curious. I don't know if we need to know that kind of stuff.
No.
Okay. I mean, I was just curious.
I thought it was like a thought question.
You're just more worried about the fact.
Yeah, really.
No, I don't ask you that kind of question. No.
So I just know that both sympathetic and parasympathetic are activated.
Yeah.
I just have a question. Is dive reflex based on water on the whole body? I thought it was water on the face.
Yeah. It was the face. That's what John was saying. Is there a difference in the
asking,
body?
Yeah. I was asking if it was the whole body, if it would be any different.
And then came up with, we don't know. We're not totally sure. All right. Frog heart has A, this, So the first part, we stimulated extrasystolic contractions, the stimulated ventricle and early or late diastole to get the extrasystolic or the preventricular contraction. So based on the Frank-Starling law, your extrasystolic contraction will have blank tension than normal. Smaller tension than your normal contraction, but your post-extrasystolic contraction will have a greater, larger tension. There will also be a longer compensatory pause between contractions. Compensatory pause in extrasystolic from early diastole will be blank than late diastole. Longer, smaller?
Longer. The longer?
Longer, yeah. Why? So because of Frank Starling law, your extrasystolic contraction has less time to fail, so your smaller contraction, but your post extrasystolic contraction has a longer time to fail, and for the greater contraction. Compensatory pause is caused by the refractory period, not allowing your depolarization of your muscle cells. You won't have any contraction. Once you guys download it, there'll be waves in there. Alright, so the vagus nerve, we have stimulated the vagus nerve to produce bradycardia, decreasing heart rate, and cardiac arrest. Your vagus nerve carries your parasympathetic nerve that releases acetylcholine. Acetylcholine will slow your SA node and decrease the conduction of action potentials through the AV node. And then if we continuously stimulate it, the parasympathetic activity highly innervates your SA node, but not your AV node or your ectopic cells. Therefore, other pacemaker cells take over, but your heart rate will be slower than the SA node. Okay. I don't remember what the question was like, but he gave, but he suggests like a... He has questions that I've seen. I'm sure he has a large bank of questions and holds whatever he wants. There was once like a snapshot of biohack with an extrasystolic contraction, and then it was like about time. How long will your next? What time? At what time will your next beat come back? Or at what pace?
Which is?
you had to look at what, how long your extrasystolic contraction took, or was, how what time it was, and then you have to add that difference in time to your next one. Time and then yeah, you had to look at how long it took.
Can I
not
take it out?
I think so. Yeah.
So is it extra solid 2 5 seconds, and the normal took 10 seconds.
Let's see if I have it.
Take time to Oh, it's gonna be a long.
No, I'm not gonna say.
Like whenever I see statues, like half of them are big, it just makes me more hungry.
You know what, this just happened on test day, I'm interested.
The only problem is we're talking about it. Are we gonna see the man in person who's all the talking? I don't even know what he looks like, so. And this lap? It was one of the days I was.
No, not in ours. I'm out of there by like 3 PM.
That's nice.
No, I see him when I come back.
Inspiratory reserve value. And then you have to look at, well, you need to know where it is, right, in your wave, first of all. And then he'll tell you each Y marker is 5, whatever. He'll give you the units, and then you just do the math, and that's the value. Mm-hmm. So your vital capacity, your tidal value, your inspiratory reserve value, looked at minute ventilation. Then we looked at gas composition and lung volume, and we measured CO2 and the duration of breath holds. So CO2 before breath hold, you should have the normal breathing was your middle. Rebreathing should have been your largest CO2 value. Hyperventilation should have been your smallest. Your CO2 after breath hold ideally should have been the same. And then your duration of breath hold should have been normal, should have been your middle, rebreathing, your smallest duration, hyperventilation, your longest duration. And then when you were measuring inspiration, expiration, forced exhalation is your shortest. Normal expiration is your second shortest. Normal inspiration is your second longest. Forced inhalation should have been your longest. Why? Because of your chemoreceptors. The change in CO2 in your blood are sensed by your central and peripheral chemoreceptors. You also have your Herring-Brewer effect, which drives the force of inhale. And further inspiratory efforts are not inhibited, so you want to breathe. And your lung volume. and your subject was on the bike, and then you're increasing workloads, and we saw tidal value, respiration rate, CO2. As workload increased, what happened to tidal value, respiration rate, minute ventilation, and minute CO2?
Increase.
Should have seen an increase. And your percent CO2 should have seen constant or decrease. And that's because exercise increases demand for O2 and produces more CO2 that has to be removed. And your respiratory rate increases far less than your tidal volume. And then many other mechanisms. So many we don't know. Release of AMP, and AMP does all that. So you guys excreted from your hypothalamus. ADH then increases your water reabsorption and collecting drugs, and you have aldosterone. Opposite effect of AMP, and facilitates your water and sodium. Then we looked at specific gravity. You should have seen a decrease in your hypotonic or an increase in your bicarbonate. You should have seen no change ideally in the rest of them. That's because your isotonic subject is secreting more salt and water, so osmolarity shouldn't change much. Your hypotonic subject is excreting more daily urine, and your bicarbonate may not change and just excrete more ions. Then we looked at pH, and pH, the only one that really should have changed is your bicarbonate, and that should be able to create less hydrogens. Hydrogen ions, not all the bicarbs reabsorb in the PCT. Sodium clearance, your isotonic should have increased or small change, hypotonic decreased. That's because your sodium clearance should be smaller than your GFR. Sodium clearance can increase the flow rate, increases more than sodium concentrations decrease. Alright. That formula.
Wait, that's the formula that they're gonna, it's one of the formulas they're gonna give us, right?
Yeah, for the slab we'll give you the formulas. Okay, so GFR, what did we use as an estimator GFR for this lab?
3:18
clearance. So your GFR should increase for your isotonic and your hypotonic. And then that goes based on volume load. So you increase your extracellular fluid volume, which increases your hydrostatic pressure that favors filtration. Okay, and then those are your table to help you guys with AMP and ADH. For lab 7, in a healthy adult, which substance is not cleared by the kidney? Sodium, glucose, urea, creatine, or none of the above?
Glucose.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, sorry. There's multiple choices. Right.
But glucose can be excreted here if you're eating a lot of sugar, right? Like if you eat too much, like if you have a day where you like overload on eat a lot of sugar, you will clear glucose, right? Calcium-free ringer solution caused a decrease in tension.
VAR. Just learn calcium is important for both your slow waves of the pacemaker cells and your instances of cells of the pulse and for contraction. So you get calcium from your Golgi channel calcium channels or from your sarcoplasmic reticulum. There's your excitation contraction coupling, your calcium bias of your calmodulin, calcium calmodulin complex that has two roles, bias of calvesmin or calponin, and then activates your myosin like chain kinase. Here, and then here's a nice little table for you guys to compare your skeletal, cardiac, and smooth muscles. Bring a Scantron, bring a calculator. Lecture hall. Science lab. Science lecture hall.
Science
lecture hall.
Science.